Amen. Thank you, Brother Dave. Did you know that 15 minutes can save you 50% of your car insurance?
I think it's like 7 minutes now or something, bro.
Get out. Stuck my toe. No, really, did you know that? Did you also know that everybody knows that? Did you know that God loves you?
Amen.
Amen. You know that?
Amen.
The theme of love was what God put on my heart when Pastor Scott asked me to bring the word this morning. And Brother Paul, who's not here this morning, you know it's better when Brother Paul's here.
Amen.
It is. It's better when you're here. It goes for every one of you in here. It's better when you're here.
Amen.
Brother Paul came up and said, yeah, I watched this really cool movie the other night. It's called Ragamuffin. It's about this Christian guy in the 80s. And so I told Mary, I said, you know, look, we watch all different kinds of movies and stuff, and sometimes it's not, you know, very uplifting. And the other night I said, you know, we just need something uplifting. And so I said, well, let's watch our Ragamuffin. So we put it on there. It's a story of Rich Mullins. Any of you know who Rich Mullins is?
Oh, yeah.
Number one song, Awesome God. He wrote the song, Awesome God.
Wow.
And his story, it's an amazing story. It's a really cool story. His life was taken short. I don't think he fulfilled the destiny that God had for him. He died in a tragic car accident along with a friend. But the beginning of the movie starts with a preacher who they later on introduced into the movie, who was very influential in his life. And he said something that really stuck with me. He said, when we stand before the Lord in judgment, he said, I think that God's going to say one thing. He's going to say, did you know that I loved you?
Bless him.
Do you know that? Do you know that God loves you? We walk around so oftentimes with just intense struggles. Struggles real. If you missed Sunday school, you should have been here. It's better when you're here.
That's right.
Struggle, I think, unnecessarily.
That's right.
I'm not saying there aren't struggles. It has to do with your perception of what the struggle is.
Come on.
What the intention of that struggle is. What's it there for? Mm-hmm. Why are we going through this struggle? Why does it tell us to count it all a joy when we fall into various trials? A lot of times we bring those struggles on ourselves. It has nothing to do with God's intent on putting us through a struggle.
That's right.
We bring it on ourselves.
That's right.
God has nothing to do with that. So many times I've been to prison, and so many times I've heard those guys say, yeah, well, I know God's got a plan. God didn't plan for you to go to prison.
That's right.
I'm not saying he can't use you while you're in there, but his plan was not for you to go to prison.
That's right.
And there's many struggles that we engage in that God did not intend us to engage in. There's a book I read called Love Does. And as soon as I said that, the man's name escapes me, who wrote it. And if you're really interested, you can look it up. Just put, you know, book, Love Does. It's, the guy's name will come to me, but it's just an amazing book. And I mean, that, you know, it is, you know, it's like, I am, that says it, I am. You don't have to say anything else. Love does. Love does. That covers so many different aspects of what it means. The first scripture verse, I'm not going to ask you to turn to it. And Shiloh, you know what? You don't even need to put it up on the screen. This one I'm just going to read. And I'm going to ask that you all close your eyes. I know it sounds kind of weird. I want you to close your eyes. I want to paint a picture for you. All right? As I read this to you. So from Deuteronomy. It's Deuteronomy 11, starting in verse 8. Listen what this says. It says, but the land which you enter to possess is a land of hills and valleys which drinks water of the rain of the heavens. A land for which the Lord your God cares. The eyes of the Lord your God are always upon it from the beginning of the year to the end of the year. Keep your eyes closed. I want you to think about what's your paradise? Is it you got your toes stuck in the sand, you're on the beach somewhere and you can just hear the waves lapping up on the shore. Maybe you're in the mountains. Maybe you're from the country. You just like that cool breeze. You're just sitting on the porch. You've got a rocking chair. You're enjoying a sweet tea and that just that cool breeze from the mountains just coming your way. I'm not sure what that is, but I want you to hear what the Lord says. It says, "And if you will diligently heed my commandments, which I command you this day to love the Lord your God and to serve him with all your mind and heart, with your entire being, I will give you the rain for your land in its season, the early rain and the latter rain, that you may gather in your grain, your new wine, your oil. I'll give you grass in your fields for your cattle that you may eat and be full. Take heed to yourselves, lest your minds and your hearts be deceived and you turn aside and serve other gods and worship them." He says, "And the Lord's anger be kindled against you, and he shut up the heavens so that there will be no rain and that the land will not yield its fruit. And you perish quickly off the good land which the Lord gives you. Therefore you shall lay up these, my words, in your minds and hearts and your entire being and bind them up for a sign upon your hands and as forehead bands between your eyes. You shall teach them to your children, speaking of them when you sit in your house and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you rise up, and you shall write them upon the doorposts of your house and your gates, that your days and the days of your children may be multiplied in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers to give them, as long as the heavens are above the earth. For if you diligently keep all this commandment, which I command you to do, to love the Lord your God, and to walk in his ways, and to cleave to him, then the Lord will drive out all these nations before you, and shall dispossess nations greater and mightier than you. Every place upon which the sole of your feet shall tread shall be yours. From the wilderness to Lebanon, from the river to the river Euphrates, to the western sea, Mediterranean, your territory shall be. There shall be no man able to stand before you. The Lord your God shall lay the fear and the dread of you upon all the land that you shall tread. As he has said to you, behold, I set before you this day a blessing and a curse. The blessing, if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I commanded you this day. And the curse, if you will not obey the commandments of the Lord your God, but turn aside from which the way I have commanded you this day to go after other gods, which you have not known. Okay, you can open your eyes. I could preach an entire message just on this, but I want to try to encapsulate a few different things about love. This talks about what God has promised to give us. But there are conditions upon these promises. We must obey. We must obey his commands. We must walk in his ways to possess the land. The problem is what we try to do is we stay on our side and we run into that land that he told us we could possess. We grab a few things and we run back. And we live our lives the way that we want to. And then sometimes we just kind of clean it up a little bit. When we need something, then we run into the land again that he told us we could possess. And then we come back. And we go back to life as usual. Struggles that even need not be.
That's right.
It says that we shall lay up these words in our minds and hearts and bind them for a sign upon our hands, put them on our forehead, teach our children. Why? I need Sister Wilma, I need Brother Dave, I need their wisdom to teach me. I don't know it all. I need Pastor Scott, who's a man wise beyond his years. Why? Because he heeds the advice and the wisdom from those elders above him. I want that. I want
Amen.
That.
Amen.
I hope that my children will desire that. Hope that I can pass that on to them. Because that's where the rubber meets the road.
That's right.
That's how they're going to deal with the rest of their life. The love that I show them, the same love from the fathers, the love that I extend to them, that's all that's going to get it done. We must cleave to his ways. It says in Psalm 91, it says, in verse 14, it says, "Because he has set his love upon me, Therefore, I will deliver him. That's the Lord speaking through David. He said, because he set his love on me, I will deliver him. The one says, I will set him on high because he knows and understands my name. It means he has we have a personal knowledge of his mercy, his love, and his kindness, his trust. He relies on me, knowing I will never forsake him, no, never.
That's right.
He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. Listen to what it says right here. I will be with him in trouble.
Amen.
We are going to experience trouble. But the trouble that I want to experience is not of my own doing. It's trouble that I know the Lord God will deliver me out of and protect me through all the days of my life. Because that trouble I can turn and use as a testimony for his glory and his goodness.
That's right.
Because I know that I know that I know that no matter what, nothing can stand before me.
That's right.
It says, I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him.
Amen.
What else is there to say? I'll deliver him. That's God's promise.
Yes.
That is God's promise.
Yes. Yes.
Because we set our love on him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we say we set our love on him. And listen, just like the pastor says, when we're up here, whoever's up here, we're not just preaching to you all. Trust me on that. We're preaching to ourselves.
Amen.
I want you to hear what it says in Hosea. It's in the Old Testament. The Old Testament's got some good stuff in there. In chapter 14 of Hosea, it's what it says, O Israel, return to the Lord your God, for you have stumbled and fallen. You visited been visited by calamity due to your iniquity.
That's right.
Take with you words and return to the Lord. Say to him, take away all our iniquity, accept what is good and receive us graciously. So we will render our thanks as bullocks to be sacrificed and pay the confession of our lips. All right. It says right here, return to the Lord your God, for you have stumbled and fallen. You've been visited by calamity due to your iniquity. Iniquity is sin, folks. That's what it is. I'm just putting it right out there. Now, this message may not be for everybody, but it's for some people. Now, whether you're a born-again Christian, and you've fallen, maybe you've backslid, maybe you've made some bad choices, some things that you think that you just, it's tough to reconcile with the Lord. Or maybe you don't know the Lord as your Savior. Maybe you've never asked Jesus Christ into your heart and don't understand that we are born into iniquity. You don't understand that. That's okay. I didn't know it. I had no idea. 33 years of my life, blinders on. I had no idea. Just living my life, partying, having a great time. Man, it's all good. Till one day I woke up.
Amen.
And wanted to kill myself. And I knew something had to change. And what changed was the love of God. I allowed that love to come in and change me. This is what I want you to key in on here. It says, take with you words. Doesn't that sound weird? I read that. I thought, that's weird. Take with you words and return to the Lord. When we return to God, we need to return to God on his terms. Not on our terms.
That's right.
And that's what we do a lot. We come back for a short while on our terms. And it's basically the old pilot, co-pilot thing. Lord, you take it from here. And the Lord writes the ship. We go, okay, scoot over. I'm good. I'm back. And then we look at the radar and we go, whoa. You know, simple illustration. It's really kind of neat. If you draw a straight line from L.A. to, Honolulu. You're going on a boat. I mean, it looks pretty simple, a straight line. You know, if you're off just the smallest amount, you won't even come close to the island. Just the smallest amount. You won't even see it. And a lot of times that's what we do with our walk. We say we're fixed on Christ. And points we are. It's just a little, just a little turn, and we miss it. We miss him. We have to come back to God on his terms. not on our term. It's not enough to feel repentant. Feelings are not enough. You know that feelings are not enough? Feelings only do so much. It's actions that make the difference.
That's right.
David didn't just say he wanted to repent. David repented. He did it. His actions spoke much, much louder than the feelings in his heart. Because we all get those feelings of guilt, that feeling like we've wronged the Lord in some way or another. And what do? We just feel contrition in our hearts, but we don't act on the repentance that is necessary and called for in the Word of God. It says that there's two kinds of sorrow. There's a godly sorrow and a worldly sorrow. And I think too many Christians just basically mask or deceive themselves in that the worldly sorrow is enough. It is not. Because the Bible tells us that worldly sorrow leads to death. But godly sorrow leads to repentance. And that means, very simple, it's not rough stuff. It's just a turning away. That's it.
That's right.
Turn away. Turn away from those ways. Yes. Bible says that we're to walk in His ways. He wants us to possess the land.
That's right.
It's about the love. The love that is in our heart for Him. Deuteronomy, turn with me. Deuteronomy 10, 12, and 15. Okay, it says, now remember that, words, right? We key in on words. Now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you? But reverently to fear the Lord your God, that is, what does that mean? That is, to walk in all His ways, and to love Him, to serve the Lord your God with all your mind, heart, with your entire being, to keep the commandments of the Lord and His statutes, which I command today for you. Those are the actions. Those aren't feelings. It's not. You can't feel like you're going to walk in His way. You can't feel like it. That doesn't do it. That doesn't execute it. And so this modern day mantra that it's just enough to believe is absolute hogwash.
That's right.
I remember for the first 5 years after I got saved going to a Bible study, and every now and then it would come up, you know, we're not saved, we're saved by grace, not of works, right? Lest any man should boast. Brother Brett, what are we created for?
Good works.
Good works. Good works. Ooh, wait, I guess you can't work for your salvation. No, you can't. We're created unto good works. Why? Because we're supposed to love God. And if we love God, we will keep His commandments. What are His commandments? What are His commandments? To love our neighbor as ourself. You know, sometimes love takes a sacrifice. What do I mean by that? When you go out of your way to pick someone up for church, away. If you love God, you're not going out of your way. You're not going out of your way if you love God. Because that's what we do. What about somebody's loved one passes away? What do? You juggle your schedule. That's what you do. Right, Mama? Right? That's right. What do when somebody's in the hospital? You juggle your schedule. You go see them. Why? Because we love God. And we want to do what God called us to do. It's not a burden if you love the Lord. It's only a burden if there's a disconnect in that relationship where you feel it's a burden. When you feel like you can't cook any more meals for the chicken soup ministry. Think, man, I've done this every week. Where does the money come from? You can't outgive God.
That's right.
You can't outgive God. You can't do it. It's not possible. You can't do it. The love of God is something that I think so few Christians have experienced. I don't know if it's for fear a willingness to work at it. We get to a certain point. It's like at our jobs, there's not just at our jobs, any job. When you're in sales, there's plateaus. You get to about like $150,000. I know that's a lot of money. But when the difference between $150,000 and $250,000 may not seem much on paper, but it's monumental in terms of the effort that you must put forth in order to get to that next level. And so what happens a lot of times is people just, they get comfortable. Now, don't get me wrong. Easy to be comfortable on $150,000. However, to get to that next level, a lot of times people just say, "Well, good. I'm gonna schedule my life and I'm gonna live my life just like this. Because $150,000, I do all I need to do right here. I'm all good. I don't need any more. Got a sweet car. Got a couple of toys. My kids are in private school. Whatever it is, right? I think that's what a lot of Christians do. They get comfortable." They get to where, I just want to step out of their comfort zone. They don't want to pursue the Lord. The God says to seek first the kingdom of God. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added onto you. The love. We have to develop the same love that Christ had for us. For him. That we don't that there is nothing between us and our neighbor. Let's start right here in this church. Let's start right here, like the pastor said just a few months ago. Let's get this right. And let's take it out into the community. Turn with me to John 14 and 23. Electronic malfunction. I knew it was going to happen. That's okay. I have a backup. That's not the devil. Just saying. Okay. John 14, 23, it says, Jesus answered, if a person really loves me, he's calling us out right here. He's saying, he's not just talking to the disciples, folks. He's talking to us. If a person really loves me, he'll keep my commandments. Hello.
Amen.
It doesn't get any easier than that. We cannot pick and choose which ones we want to follow. Does not mean that we may make a mistake. But the Bible says that my little children, Peter writes this, I write these that you sin not, that you don't sin. So there is the example. We're not supposed to sin. But if you do, you got an advocate.
Amen.
Don't use it, as Paul says, as a cloak of maliciousness where we can just go, oh, we got a ticket. We're going to get out of jail free cards. We're just going to put the hammer down, let it rip. No, that's not what it's saying. If they really love me, they'll keep my commandments. It says, obey my teachings. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him.
Amen.
Man, how sweet does that sound? I mean, did you have your eyes closed? You're thinking about the front porch. I know most of the people here are front porch people. They're thinking about that Cracker Barrel rocker, man. Oh, Lord. And you got that sweet tea, and the pitcher is just, man, just the water, the condensation is rolling down the side of it. Oh, man, is that sweet?
Glory.
We can have that. That's what he's talking about, folks. That is what he's talking about. That, guess what? But that doesn't mean... That doesn't mean that there aren't going to be storms. It doesn't mean that you're not going to have issues. It doesn't mean the rocker isn't going to break. It doesn't mean that. He's going to give us the tools to fix the rocker if it breaks or if we spill our tea. We'll go get another glass.
Amen.
All right? He's given us a land to possess. He said in Deuteronomy that it doesn't matter who comes against us. The enemy, it doesn't matter. If God is for us, who can be against
us? That's right.
We sing these songs week after week after week after week, but we don't apply them to our lives. They become something cool. And I'm not trying to get on you. I'm just saying, stop that. Break the bubble. Break out of your comfort zone with regard to how you serve the Lord and how you love Him.
That's right.
He says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments.
Yes.
But we think by some strange phenomenon that if we don't, nobody else knows and we can get away with it. God is there every time you do it.
That's right.
He knows with what intent, why, whatever reason.
That's right.
You can rationalize all you want. God is there and He knows. And He's saying, no. Why do we do it? Usually because we're pressured or we feel some sort of oppression. He says, what? Come unto me, all you that are heavy laden. I'll give you rest. Cast your cares on Him. He cares for you. That's what the Word of God says. But a lot of times we want to go into shell. Sister Melissa shared this morning. She said, I didn't reach out to anybody. I found myself isolated. Wasn't reading my Word. Wasn't praying. Something was off kilter. Do you know what got her back on board? What? How old is Bella? Six?
Seven.
Seven-year-old little girl.
Amen.
Said, you know, if you dig deep, you'll find something sweet.
Glory to God.
Bible says not to forsake the assembling of ourselves, right?
Amen.
Such as we see the day approaching. There's a reason for that. We need to be able to confide in one another. You need to build
Amen.
Relationships.
Amen.
Men need to build relationships with men
yes.
that they can talk openly and honestly about things that they're doing, issues that they're going through. Women need to counsel with women
yes.
so that they can understand the things that they're going through. And when those dark things are exposed into the light of His glory and grace, God can do wonderful things.
That's right.
It goes on to say, hold on, and thank, well, let her rip. Come on now. It's God's glory. John 21 and 15. And we're not going to read the whole thing. The whole point of this, 21 and 15, this is where Jesus said to Peter, he grilled him, he gave him, Dennis, do you love the Lord?
Yes, I do.
Really?
Yes, I do.
Do you really love the Lord, Dennis?
I really love the Lord.
Dennis, do you love the Lord?
Yeah.
Okay. Right? He did that three times. He said, well, listen, when you're converted, strengthen the brethren. Do you strengthen the brethren? Are you one who builds up, edifies, and strengthens the brethren? You know what Rich Mullins said in that movie? It was so awesome. He said, you know what? I didn't get saved because I was raised in church. I didn't get saved because I had some big epiphany. He said, I got saved because of people in church.
Amen.
He said, they're the nuts and bolts. They're the nuts and bolts. And I'm not gonna make a joke about that. We're the nuts and bolts. Do you know that people's perception of what church is you?
That's right.
It's what you do at work.
Mm-hmm.
It's what you do at home, in front of your children, with your spouse, coworkers, family members. That's what church is. It's what it is. The kingdom of God that people know is in your heart. It's what you show them. That's why we got some messed up churches. I don't think this is a messed up church, but I know that there's some people that haven't experienced the love of God or have showered the love on God. May He shower on us. Be the nuts and bolts.
Amen.
That's what God wants.
That's right.
All right. Turn to Hebrews 10:24. We're going to bring it in for landing. Hebrews 10:24. Another electronic conference. That's okay. I will not be deterred. In Jesus' name.
Won't be shaken.
Where did I say to go?
Hebrews 10:24.
There you go. Come on, Hebrews. All right. Hebrews 10:24.
You know, that won't happen with a paperback, brother.
Well, yeah. Amen to that. But when this is working, all right. Let us consider and give attentive attentive, and continuous care to what? Watching over one another. Studying how we may stir up. That means to stimulate, means to incite. I love those words. To love and helpful deeds and noble activities. Here we go. Not forsaking or neglecting to assemble together as believers, as is the habit of some people. It's better when you're here. But admonishing one another, and all the more faithfully as you see the day approaching. For if we go on deliberately and willingly sinning after once acquiring the knowledge of the truth, there's no longer any sacrifice to atone for our sins. Says, there's nothing left for us then, but a kind and awful and fearful prospect and expectation of divine judgment, and the fury of burning wrath and indignation which will consume those who put themselves in opposition to God. That's what we do when we sin. And I don't say these things to scare you, but while we place our trust and faith in the fact that God is a righteous judge, we get over here and go, oh, yeah, but God, do you remember all the good things I did? It's not going to work.
That's right.
He's going to stand there and he's going to say,
"That's right.
Did you know how much I loved you? Did you know how much I loved you?" We have to care and watch over one another. Why? So we can stir up the gifts inside of each other. I'll stir up the gifts in Alexa and Alyssa, Hannah, Bubba. I want them. I want there to be a waiting list. I want there to be a waiting list for people who want to come on the
right.
Worship team. I want people to flood Sister Shelley's phone with messages about how they want to be in the nursery.
Yeah.
You know what? That's not happening. That's not happening. It's not happening. And we've got children to raise.
Mm-hmm.
We got to stir up the gifts in each other. We have to encourage each other to do what God has called us to do. Okay, 1 John 2:5-6. Oh, this is good stuff. He says, but he who keeps treasures, his word. Remember words? Words count for something. He says, who bears in mind his precepts, who observes his message in its entirety, not some of it, all of it. It says, truly in him has the love of God been perfected. Wouldn't that be awesome if you knew that the love of God was perfected in you? And that's what we strive for. That's got to be the mark that Paul talks about. He said, I press toward the mark of the high calling of God. Man, I think that's it right there, that the love of God would be perfected in me, completed, reaching maturity. By this we may know, we may perceive and recognize and be sure that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him should, as a personal debt, walk and conduct himself in the same way in which he, capital H, he walked and conducted himself.
That's right. That's right.
The Bible says it over and over. It's real simple. Do what I say. Do what I said. And a lot of times what we do, we've all said it. Do as I say, not as I do. Right? How many times have we said that? All right, Romans 13:10. We've all said that. And we got to stop. We have to be the godly example God's called us to be. It says in 13:10, it says, love does no wrong. Love does. Love does. You can put that on anything. Love does.
Mm-hmm.
Boom, it's the same. Love does, Robin. Love does no wrong to one's neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
Never hurts anybody.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, love meets all the requirements and is the fulfilling of the law. Listen to this. Therefore, love meets all requirements and is the fulfilling of the law. I have been serving the Lord for probably, I think, 16 years now. I never knew this. We always hear about the law, right? I always heard about the law. Did you know there was something like the next notch up? You know, there's like average and then there's above average. Did you know that there was something above the law? I never knew this. The royal law. Do you know the term royal law in the King James Version is used one time? Once. That's all it's used. It's in the book of James. In 2:8, and it says, if indeed you really fulfill the royal law, in accordance with the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as you love yourself, you do well. You know what I love, Dennis? Loving the Lord. You know when you take a phone call from somebody who's struggling, it's 10 o'clock, spending your time with your family, with your wife or your husband, but somebody needs you and you take that call, that's love. And when your spouse understands that, that's love. That's loving God, knowing that it's not about what's happening here. And I'm not saying don't neglect your families, and I'm not saying, you know, we have to parse our time accordingly, because surely we do. I'm saying that we have to love.
That's right.
As He loved. Love. This is the final scripture verse, and you don't have to turn. Okay. Romans 8:35. Says this, who shall ever separate us from Christ's love? Who can do that?
Nobody.
Shall suffering and affliction and tribulation, it didn't for Paul, didn't for Peter, didn't for John. They went through tribulation, struggles. We don't know what struggling is here. There isn't anybody in this room that knows what struggles compared to this is like.
That's right.
No one here has ever had to fear for their life because of the gospel's sake. Paul sat in jail and sang songs praising God.
Glory to God.
When's the last time you did that when you were going through a struggle? Paul did that because he loved God. Because God changed his life. He says, what about calamity or distress? You know what? If you know that the trouble you're in is trouble that God brought upon you because He knows and He wants to perfect something in you.
That's right.
Then you're going to make it.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. So what about persecution or hunger, destitution or peril or sword? Nope. Mm-hmm. None of that. The only thing that can separate us is us.
That's right. That's right.
What you do is not going to change the love that God has for you. But my question is, what are you going to do to show the God of the universe who sent His Son while we were yet sinners to put on the greatest act of love ever known to man, where He shed His blood for our sins? I'm going to ask you today, what words are you going to bring to Him today?
Amen.
What words are you going to bring to Him? Those words don't have to be many. They can be few. They just have to be from the heart. They have to be real. And so I want to encourage you. Sean, can I get you? Where's my girl? Rach, you want to come up? We sang that song this morning, Now's the Time to Worship. It says, one day every tongue will confess you are God, and one day every knee will bow. Still, the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. This altar is always open. And I don't know if this message was for you this morning, but I'm certain, knowing the way that God works, somebody will send me a text that says, man, that was right where I was today. That's what I needed to hear. Maybe they were calling to tell me that. Oh, wait, it's not online. I don't know. I know these altars are open. And I know there's a lot of you in this room that could give some words to the Lord. I think we sit in these chairs and we're afraid to come to the altar because we think if somebody sees me come up to the altar, they might think something's going on. What are they going to think? That's right, what are they going to think? Ooh, they got sin in their life. No. There's nothing like some good altar time. I'm going to duck down here and I'm going to share some words with the Lord. You don't have to come up here. You can do it right in your seat. You can go. I love you all. It's better when you're here. But I'm going to give some words to the Lord. I love you all. Thank you.